Action. Sorry. Sync the mic, sorry.
Right, we start all of them. So the reason for me coming down is just to talk a bit about what we've done at Dalhousie. I mean, it's going to be interesting. What I'll do is I'll start with telling a story, really, about what we've done and what sort of got us to the point where we were even considering Best Value. And I guess I'll tell a bunch of stories, and then we'll sort of show what the outcome has been on a number of the different projects that we've done. And then I'll leave it open at the end, and I'm going to try and make this as fast as I can, really, to discuss really what are the parallels or learnings that we have that might be of interest to you, or if you have any questions, give you some time to talk to them. Basically, where I'm going. So we started in May 2013. Realistically, we actually started the whole idea of Best Value about 1 year earlier. But since then, we've done about 18 projects, although the 18th is actually right now in procurement, so we really haven't gotten that one really off its feet. But we've got really 17 projects that Dalhousie done under Best Value in the capital construction area. So the way Dalhousie is a little different, we have two different capital groups. One is minor capital, which is the group that I oversee, and the other is major capital, which is overseen by a different director. The majority of the projects have been minor capital, and that'll be the ones that I'll be speaking to, although there have been some major capital. So our difference is anything under $5 million is considered minor capital. And we do about 300 projects like that a year. There's about 11 project managers. And on the major capital side, we do probably about $40 to $45 million a year across a much smaller group of about two or three project managers. And so all of us still are in the same relationship with procurement and legal, who are separate from our umbrella. They're both managed by different ADPs. So it's different. We were going through the different structures today and noticing just, you know, there's quite a bit of variety. So for me, legal and procurement are very different entities and are run by different people. And they are groups that I have to learn to get along with very well. So, just as a quick overview so you get an idea sort of where we're at, these are the different types of projects. And so we've run everything from, you know, $115,000, which is basically a demolition job that has a lot of asbestos abatement in it, up to some major components inside some of, so this one here, Capital Classroom Building and Shed, that's $21 million in a single lump sum. But also then this one here, Capital Classroom Building Learning Commons Construction, that one was actually done as a sort of hybrid construction management style. So there's a number of different styles, but most of what is done under my group is just single lump sum contracts, usually to a single general. So to give you where we're at. And then dollar values vary in between, again, about 115 up to, well, in my world, they're up to about 7 million. So just trying to give you the overall picture. And so my role is that I oversee the 11 or so project managers who then oversee all of the work. We do not, like you, have internal architects or engineers per se that design the work. All of our work is designed outside. So we have to hire all of our consulting teams from the outside. And we do have internal engineers and architects who act as review agents, but none of them actually stamp or sign any of our drawings. So again, that's a little bit of a difference from where I know you folks are. So there's the general picture where we're at in terms of Best Value. I just wanted to show that slide first, but really the real learning, what we learned, and we learned it the hard way, and I guess what Best Value really kind of came to us from, was an experience where we had a number of very large project failures. And in one case, it was a severe project budget overrun, and in another case, it was a schedule that almost overrun, and if it had overrun, would have caused some really severe results. So, as having come out of those two experiences, we went to a Best Value conference put on by, it was Ken at the time, and another fellow, Brian, and they sat us down and they were like, well, guys, we know you guys probably are having some problems with your projects. We're like, yeah, we definitely get that. They tell you this, but the real source of all your problems, is it your contractors? We're like, yeah, man, they suck. No. Is it your architect or engineers? It's like, yeah, they may make mistakes. No. Because you know what the real root of the problem? Is you. And in a very gentle and polite way, Ken walked us through how the system by which we procure construction services and then manage them, and contract them and then manage them, creates a really adversarial environment. And the resulting behaviors that we see out of the contractor, such as predatory contractors, or the resulting behavior we see from, let's say, issues we might have with legal, where there's lots of what appears to be obstruction to moving things forward, is a result of the way in which you've gone about doing your business for so long. So I'll give you an example. So we are part of the problem. And I'll tell you, this is a fundamental piece, because I think for us, when we started Best Value, we started from a position of, I'll call, slight trauma, where people have been taken to boards of governors and have had uncomfortable conversations where we internally were feeling the heat that our, to all of our best efforts, we were still having difficulty executing our project. So here was our thinking at the time. Okay, I'm going to divide this into procurement, legal, and project management. So at the beginning, right, we think of procurement as awarding to the lowest compliant bidder. We always play with that word, compliant, right? You know, you want to play around, but lowest compliant bidder. And so we had a project where we had a kitchen renovation. It was basically a kitchen and a servery in a major dormitory. And in that kitchen, it was both the back of the house and the front of the house. So by the time we get into this renovation, we're going to have the entire place taken apart. It's about a $3.2 million project. It was rushed because the client, from our perspective, which was ancillary services who run our dormitories and related student services, suddenly got a bunch of money they want to spend quick. I don't know, it's common.
That never happened.
Yeah, exactly. So having said that, they're like, okay, we need this to get to tender. We're like, we're already behind the eight ball. They're like, I know, but just do it. We've got to do it. So knowing full well that we were rushing into a procurement with probably drawings that weren't complete, we still pushed ahead with our normal process, right, which is to award the lowest compliant bidder. And in order to do that, we assume, in order for that to work, that the vendor is going to do exactly what we tell them to do. And therefore, since we've told them exactly what has to do, what has to be done, all we have to do is pick the person at the lowest cost, because they're just going to do it exactly what we want to do at the lowest cost. But of course, if you think the drawings were perfect, if you think we had a good idea of what was really going to be the concealed conditions in that building, right, not at all. So the outcome, of course, is that we got a contractor, and guess what? He was low bid, and when he came in, he was very smiley and telling us about how he was going to meet the schedule and all the good things he had and how he had all the subcontractors lined up. And, you know, he had all these other big projects on the go, such as Walmart's, which should have been a warning sign to us, because if you're competing with Walmart for someone's resources, you're going to be in trouble. however, at the time, it seemed to be a great idea. However, what we had really done was create a system where that contractor had come in, had seen the errors in the drawings, had cut his cost because he knew he was going to make it back. And that's not uncommon. We all know that scenario, right? Now, as part of the learning that we've now had going through the best value practice, we realized that what we were really doing by setting up a procurement method like this was we were really attracting the predatory contractors to come work for us, especially on a project of the type that we had where we were behind the eight ball on the drawings. Because the only guy who's going to win that kind of job and make a profit is the one who later on is going to come back and nail us for change orders. And the people who looked at the drawings, who maybe would have said to themselves, this isn't really a good set of drawings. This doesn't really show the whole picture. Like, for example, I don't see one of the big mistakes we made is where the electrical services were running. We assumed they were running certain locations and they weren't. Would have said, I don't see where those electrical services are. I'm going to put some extra money in my bid because I know I'm going to end up hunting through some walls until I figure out where really, really the conduit is. Of course, the contractor we hired didn't even bother to think about that, didn't even have his electrical sub signed up. He just had a price from some guy based on a speculation because he didn't have to do any better than that, right? All he had to do was put in the lowest cost and then somehow survive afterwards to make a profit. And unfortunately, we're the ones who set that system up to be like that, because all we asked for was what was the lowest compliant bidder, assuming our drawings are perfect. So, okay, so but at first, it's all smiles and we're all good, right? It always is. So then we go to contract. We've got to sign a contract. Of course, the contract was written by ourselves. Now, we use a CCDC-2 in this case, but we use supplemental conditions, which heavily modify the contract. They're almost as thick as the actual channel conditions, which makes us feel good, makes us feel like, oh, wow, we've got a boilerplate contract. This is going to protect us from any problems. No matter what happens, we'll be able to pick out some super-duper clause and shoot a bunch of bullets over to the contractor and win. Now, the assumption that we made, of course, is that the contract actually gives us some sort of control. However, as the project began to progress, we saw two things happen at the beginning. There are two big warning signs that I've learned since then, because it's happened on a number of projects where we've had trouble. Two things happened. One was we had an early safety problem, and it was a simple issue that should have been picked up, where a subcontractor was just basically misbehaving, not following a proper safety practice. The reason why that was significant was because it was coupled at the same time with a lack of resources on the site, starting the project off with about a 2 to 3 week delay. So right at the beginning of the project, we saw a small safety infraction and a schedule slip. And it was the schedule slip occurred because you go on site and guess what, there's nobody there. Why is there nobody there? Because the guy hasn't really actually got all of his subcontracts in place yet. He's scrambling to get them now that he's got the job. And we're all ready, but of course he's making all kinds of excuses, and he can make that time up, and that's no big deal, and we've done this before, and I've got the best guys in the world, everything's gonna be good. And we're going, okay, but we're starting to doubt him. And sure enough, as time starts to go on, we start pulling out his schedules, and we say, look, this was your schedule, but this is where you are now. We need you to give us a plan for how you're gonna make that up. And he would be like, well, we'll do something, and give us some sort of half-assed revised schedule. We do it again. Finally, we're like, okay, look, we think you're in breach of contract. We think that you have not met the original schedule of the contract, and even though we have not reached the end date, we did have milestones identified. The milestones are in the contract. You didn't meet the milestones. Therefore, we have a breach. However, I also have to remember that this was a dormitory, and it needed to be open September 1st. So, although perhaps if we had told him, yeah, go home, we're going to sue you, we're going to fire you, we're going to do something terrible, go home while the job's half done and we're going to fight this out, because maybe we had a point under the contract that could have been followed, the reality is that was going to mean that dormitory wasn't going to have a kitchen, which at the time, the vice president, who was starting to get wind of this via the AVP, who was our essentially our client, was starting to erect a tent on the outside of the building. And we were like, why are you building that tent? He's like, oh, just in case. What do you mean, just in case? He's like, just in case we don't have a kitchen. And myself and the project manager were like, oh, no, you're going to have a kitchen. I guarantee you're going to have a kitchen. He's like, okay, thanks, that's great. But the tents kept going up. And at the time, the project manager's name was Gary. And I was very, very fortunate that Gary was on that project, because he's one of those project managers who was able to really dig down deep with the trades, talk to them personally, and we began to try to dig ourselves out of this problem as fast as we could so that there would be food on the table when those students came. And the illusion that we had some sort of power from this contract, although it was great and probably legally we might have, the reality was that we could almost see the gallows inside the tent for me and Gary if that wasn't going to get done on time. So one of the reasons, as we learn now, talking to the Best Value folks about how we were approaching that problem, is that because we write the contract ourselves entirely, don't let them put a single scratch to it, of course they see it as one-sided and probably hostile, and they're probably half right, because we definitely stacked the cards in our favor, or so we think. And so as a result, they don't feel like they really have any power in this project, and instead, they're just waiting for something to go wrong and find a section in the contract where they're gonna be able to defend themselves and probably produce some kind of a claim. So when there is a risk that suddenly shows up, for example, we had Halton controls going in, which was basically ventilation controls that manage the energy consumption by dropping the fume hoods down or the exhaust hoods down when there's low usage. They didn't arrive on time. Well, we were like, well, you have to take care of this. And the guy's like, I don't know, I can't make the supplier work for me. We're like, well, you have to, you're the general, you have to find a way. He's like, I can't do it. And he just walked away. So of course that meant that actually Gary went down to the supplier and he got on the phone and started to talk to the people who were actually manufacturing the equipment. And he made sure that even though it was a subcontract to the general, to us, that he was actually dealing with those people at that very bottom level, trying to get supply of those controls in time. Now, for those of you who know contracts, that's a big no-no. We get ourselves in big trouble doing that. But at this point, we don't care, right? Because we're just trying to survive. We're just trying to get that done. If there's a problem later on, we'll deal with it, but we've got to have an operating kitchen. And it got to the point where literally Gary, I remember we're driving up to the site on a Sunday morning to check it out, and Gary, the project manager, was hauling the garbage out on his back. And I was like, I know I have a great project manager right now, and I also know that this is a big problem. We can never, ever, ever, ever do this again. Now, what's interesting is, I didn't talk about this so much on the other slide, is that when you deal with people who are actually good at their job, who really want to do a good job, especially in trades, they don't tend to be the types who enjoy telling other people, having other people tell them what to do exactly, in particular being locked under some kind of contract. You've probably all dealt with some individual who was, I don't know, a painter or a carpenter, and you know that person does good work. And the other thing about that person is that when they come in, if you start to, let's say they're working on your house, let's say it has nothing to do with the job here, but you don't have to go through a procurement process, but when you bring them into your house, you say, look, I need this done, and I need that done, and I need that done. If you try to then sign that guy up to a contract, which is going to hem him into a whole bunch of terms and conditions, he'll just say, forget it. I don't need this. I know what I'm doing. If you don't trust that I know what I'm doing, I'll walk away and get another job somewhere else. So someone who's an expert, really, someone who actually wants to do a good job and is going to do a good job for you, is going to probably seek arrangements where they have freedom to succeed. And that's it has resistance to the idea that if I'm that person, do I really want to enter into a contract with someone where they're going to have total control over everything I do? Likewise, on the previous slide, that same expert, when they go and do the job, I mean, I'm sure you've all met the guy where you tell him, listen, I want you to do this, and he says, no. And you're like, why aren't you going to do that? And he says, because that's the wrong way to do it, and I don't do it like that. And you're like, I know, but we've got to cut something here. We've got to do it. He's like, no, I'm not really interested in doing that job. He'll walk away. I have a friend, a carpenter, who's like that. He gets himself into trouble often with his clients, but if you ask him to cut a corner, he won't. And he's also really, really, really good at what he does. He's an excellent trim carpenter. But if you think about it, if you want to get a good person doing a job, they're not going to be attracted to a job where they have to cut corners, because that makes them feel bad about their end product. Who wants to build something and walk away and know that it was bad? It's like, oh, I just built something bad. No, you want to walk away and be like, I just built something great. I can now bring my grandkid here. You can have a look at it and say, see, I built that. And they're like, wow, you really built that? Like, yeah, look, it's still standing. It looks great. Right? So people who are experts really want to see that their work is valued and that they have some control in what they're doing. And people who are good at their work are not going to be attracted to the opposite of that. And then lastly, when we get to project management, the assumption is that we will direct the work. We will tell them what to do. They will do it the way we tell them to, and if they don't, there will be consequences of some sort or another. The assumption here, though, is that the vendor has to be controlled. If you don't control them, they are going to run amok. They're going to do. There's going to be change orders. There's going to be something go wrong. I have to be in control. I have to be in control. So guess what? Project management must micromanage to be successful. I mean, taking out the garbage, how much deeper micromanaging can you get than that? When we were walking to the suppliers' shops and directly dealing with them to get the equipment, when we were having, at one point, the mechanical trade was going to lean the job and walk because he wasn't getting paid, when we have to say things like, I know your job, I know your contract is with blank, but really, you work for Dow, and we will make sure you get paid. That's crossing a line that we shouldn't cross. But it's because we've gotten to the level of micromanagement that we've actually got to talk to the individual guy to keep him from picking his bags up and walking out on the site. And of course, by doing so, we're assuming the risk. So we assumed an enormous risk once we got into that job and we're starting to do all that micromanaging. Because suddenly all those decisions, all those directives we were telling them, they were all on us. They're all our decisions. If they had screwed up, if it resulted in extra costs, there's no defense. Now, of course, someone who actually knows what they're doing, for example, you ask that same person, use this sort of tradesperson, this mythical tradesperson that comes over to your house, but we've all met one like it. When you come over and ask them to do something, they'll be like, well, that's great, but have you thought about this? Because if I put the door on the way you said and flip it around, well, there's going to be a big hole where the doorknob used to be, and the hardware was there, and how am I going to fill that? I'm never going to match. There's a common mistake, like a beginner makes, right? It's like, oh, just flip the leaf around and everything will be fine. Well, no, there'll be a hole, and then there'll be a patch, and the patch won't look right. So you'll end up painting the door, and it won't really look good because there'll be a little hole. So someone who's an expert will come in and say, you know, you really don't want to flip that door. That's not really a good idea. However, when you're micromanaging someone to death, they begin to be like, fine, I'll just do it your way. I'll just do exactly what you say, because I'm tired of you just telling me what to do all the time, and every time I do it differently, you tell me it's wrong. I'm just going to do it, and if it screws up, it's your fault. Ironically, again, on all three of these different things, so in the way we procured it, the way we contracted it, and then the way we managed it, we were always creating an environment where people who were really good at what they did would not be attracted to working for us. I mean, do you want to work for a control freak that is constantly like dropping the letter of a contract on your desk and then making you prove your value through lowest cost every time you turn around? It's not the kind of working environment most people who are good at what they do want to work with them. So having learned that, we were like, okay, you know, we've been having some trouble here. This particular kitchen project, change order rate 14%. So this was a $3.2 million project. That was a lot of money, you just didn't have. Trust me, there was a lot of different people who had to pay that piece of the money, including some partially. We obviously went after the contractor, we went after the architect. Internally, there was all kinds of infighting, if you can imagine. I'm sure you experienced that. And though we did get it done in time for September, and we did literally the day before, the kitchen got signed off by the inspector. Really, this substantial completion wasn't until December. So we really didn't make the schedule by any stretch of the imagination. We just made it look good enough that people could be fed. There was three different liens on the project. I'm assuming your lien legislation is very similar, but that means that the contractor wasn't paying his subs, which was no surprise, because guess what? Do you think we had the ace contractor? We really didn't. And the last one, which is really important, actually, is the hidden financial and human cost. So not only did Gary, who was my best project manager, suddenly have to be dedicated to that job, but suddenly I was there too. Our legal counsel was constantly involved. I remember being out with my daughter on a camping trip, fighting with the architect, while I'm trying to go on a hike with her out in the middle of the woods. And those kinds of costs add up too. I don't think I gained any gray hair on that, but I certainly could have, and Gary really was pushed to the limit. I had to give him a bit of a break afterwards. So the underlying message that we learned, especially in those first best value ones, was look, you guys did this. The reason you did this was because you got a bad contractor. We were like, yeah, no doubt. We knew he was bad like 3 weeks in. Like, we figured that out. How do we get out of that so we don't do that again? And that's when we started to learn about experts. So experts see their work as valuable. They own their work and seek arrangements that provide them freedom to succeed. And they know their work, manage it well, and despise being micromanaged. So basically, if we create systems that somehow create an environment like this, we are not going to attract those people to us. And being what we've learned now to be called a client of choice, meaning that in some senses, we too are a commodity that is out on the market, and certain contractors may choose to not work for us because simply we may be doing this to them, and that hurts their bottom line, it makes their own lives difficult, and they'd rather not bother. They'd rather go work for someone else. So instead, we want to become that someone else. We want to become that group of people that if you really know what you're doing, when you come to work for us, we will let you do the work that you are good at. We will allow some time at the beginning so there's some planning in, so that when we actually set up the contract will contain some of the elements that you yourselves came up with as part of how we will implement the project. And then we will give some evaluation credentials to people who are able to manage risk, not just who give lowest cost. Now, they call this win-win thinking. But the way for us to deal with it internally was because each one of our groups, including our legal group, our procurement group, and ourselves, had all felt the burn on all these projects. Because, of course, when it came time to actually start to deal with this contractor, we pulled out the contract, we sent letters, they were signed by the vice president, you know, all the normal stuff that has to go through. We made claims that it was legal issues, and then our procurement people had to be involved because we have to put letters of record to basically chastise this contractor to make sure we don't get back. All these people, they all were like, how do we make sure this doesn't happen again? And I think it was really critical in our story that that moment arrived when all three of our groups agreed that we needed change. And so we began to look at each other, not that we weren't always in perfect harmony before, but we began to look across the table and say, okay, what is it really that you legal or you procurement can do for me when I'm managing this project? Because if I don't find a better way to basically get our procurement out, if I don't find some way to manage our contracts differently, then all of my great project management changes isn't going to amount to a hill of beans. So we began to really work together, all of us together, on bringing in then the best value folks to begin training us internally on how to do this. And so in looking at each other then, we're like, all right, what if not only are we looking for experts on the outside, but what if we start looking at ourselves as experts on the inside? The rules that we apply to finding an expert on the outside was all those things I just said, so shouldn't that also be true of us internally? And we realized, so, and those experts are experts in something. So we sort of came up with an understanding that each one of us provides some expertise to the project that if we work together, allows us to add value and get that good person on the ground. So for example, procurement. The expertise they provide for us is to use logical deduction to remove the risk of bias. And that is painfully difficult at times, especially when you know that ABC is bad. We cannot go with ABC, but procurement's saying, well, you know, you've got to give me a justification. We've got to come up with a reason for doing that. So then it's like, okay, how do I come up with a reason? We start to go through some of the best value procurement elements that we've been talking about. But then later on, too, you want to sign these people up for a contract. What lawyers really do best, in my opinion, is they make beneficial agreements that create collaborative relationships. That is not the standard idea behind creating a contract. But if you invert what most people are setting up contracts to fight, right? Setting up the contract for the day when we're gonna have a battle and it's gonna be stacked on my side, I'm gonna have the bullets in the shot. But if instead you look at the contract as, this is our agreement for how we are going to work together towards this endpoint, fully recognizing that there will be problems along the way, fully recognizing that there will be issues as we go through, and then incorporating how we're going to manage those issues at the beginning when we're all in the honeymoon phase and the smiley phase of the project, so that then when the going gets tough, we've got a starting point to begin a collaborative relationship. And really, a good lawyer can help you get there, because really a good lawyer makes sure you never, ever, ever, ever get to court. And lastly, project management, which I know a lot of us are here in the room, and really one of the things that we do is that we manage to organize all these other experts to make sure that they're working together to create value, right? So in my case, it includes engineers and architects and also the contractors, all those subcontractors, but also some of the internal trades, our operations people, and getting all of those experts aligned so that they're working together towards a common purpose. So we've done so far 13 minor projects, 4 major, and we have seen some really good improvements. The first and most anecdotal of which is the fact that the project managers who are involved in those projects all love it. Once they figure it out, and it takes time to figure it out, it's not as straightforward as it first seems, but once they figure out how the best value process works, how managing a project through risk is a method of collaborating with the contractor and the consultants, we found anecdotally that the atmosphere and the energy around doing best value projects begins to grow and grow and grow. So at first, I only put my two best project managers on some very specific jobs that we knew would be high risk. And then as the stories come back, the other people are interested. They're like, wow, that went really well. How did you do that? Well, we had this great new process. Oh, what'd you do? Oh, by the way, we did this pre-planning piece. What was the pre-planning? Well, we talked about all the problems that were going to happen up front. And I actually got to tell the contractor before he signed them up. I said, tell me, what do you think all the change orders are going to be on this project? And he actually told me. And so instead of us waiting till later, because he already knew what the problems were, waiting till later for him to tell us what the problems were, we got it all in up front. And then we were actually able to set up a contract that already addressed those right at the beginning and had a plan that we both agreed to, because we hadn't signed any contract yet, but we both agreed to it on how we were going to manage that issue. And like, wow, okay, so then that starts to pass down. And so our change order rate, I guess the other ways of measuring it are change order rates and schedule variance. So one of the ways in which we try to really observe whether or not we are making a change is to measure it. And at first that sounds scary, but as you begin to do it, it becomes more and more easy. And when we first measured our change order rate was about 7.75% on an average project, which was okay. But it wasn't fabulous. And often every percentage of those change orders is, you know, one more gray hair in the head of the project manager, and also one more reason we've got to go in front of an AVP or a VP and make an excuse for why we need more money. Where I work, the contingency levels are very low. We often can't go back. We don't have money in the budget for, you know, any significant amount of change. If the change happens, we've got to go back and ask for more money, and that's not pleasant. So in best value projects, we've managed to get it down to about 3.25%. And again, most of the work, definitely everything we've done in terms of best value, landed on schedule. However, it is very difficult, we've been finding, to make a metric to measure this, and it's something we're trying to do now. However, again, the perception is that because the projects go so much better in terms of our management, that they're arriving in a more timely fashion. And that includes the fact that we add in about 2 weeks worth of this pre-planning element into the procurement phase, which when you do that for the first time, you feel like, why are we wasting this time? We have to get to contract and start working. But after a few repetitions of that, you start realizing, oh, no, this planning thing is really, really, really good. It's saving so much time on the other end. We've got to take the time to do this. And the major capital projects, so again, that's the over $5 million. Their change order rate is about 4, and that's in gross dollars. The change order rate per project, the reason why that's a little bit different is because we have a little bit of some funkiness in the way that the dollars get allocated internally with capital projects, but essentially the 4% change order rate would be what we would normally typically call a change order rate on a project. But here's the thing. All right, so after having gone through all the process of having suffered through some projects that were difficult, and there were some of the major capital too that I won't share now unless you want to hear it later, that then we wanted to make a change. And in doing so, we started to learn some of these principles of best value, of which one of the major ones was the idea of evaluating based around risk. There's also value adds and capability. However, it was a big, big learning curve for us to realize how much you could determine just by asking a very simple question of someone. If you just simply say to them, listen, can you just walk me through this job? Can you tell me what might go wrong and how you're going to fix it? That one simple question opens the door for the person who knows what they're doing and slams it shut for the one who doesn't. Because the person who begins to who knows what they're doing, can say, oh, I know exactly, I've done this 5 times. You've already forgotten this thing that everybody forgets over here. And that's, you know, so much money. And over here, I can tell that, you know, having worked with your client group three times before, they're going to change their mind. So I'll bet you that your layout here is about 10% wrong, at least. And probably there's also this other risk that you don't know about, of the fact that there's a supplier issue back of house that can't supply the thing that you spec'd. So even though all the other guys said they can deliver it to you on time, they really can't, because I know that product's back ordered. And by the way, I came up with an alternate. If you're interested, we can go with that instead. Right? That guy knows what he's doing. If someone else comes up to you and says, well, you know, manage the project in concert with your own desires, we'll make sure that the schedule stays on time, and we'll work with the stakeholders, and, you know, all this blah, 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 nothing specific. They're really telling you they have no clue what's going to happen, because they've never actually done it before. Now, the next step to taking to that idea is what if, going back to the beginning, if we are part of the problem, then the next question is are we experts in what we're doing? Well, how would we know? Well, we would know because we would ask ourselves that very same question. You know, what's going to happen next? Do you know what the risks are on this project? Can you tell me how you're going to manage them before they occur? And if so, you know, how would you describe that? So what we did was we took some of these same ideas and we expanded it onto ourselves. So right now, the project managers are beginning a process whereby we're going to, and are, using some of those same risk analysis tools to analyze projects that aren't necessarily best value. And carrying those tools through to begin, first of all, with the project manager, can you identify those risks up front? And then myself, as a assistant director, basically overseeing those project managers, it begins the dialogue with each other over, okay, what do you think the risks are going to be on this project? What they're going to be this. Okay, let's see what actually happens. And the project's over. And we go back and we say, so did we actually identify all the risks? No, we missed this. Oh, okay. So how can we learn to do that again next time? How are we going to manage that? So the same tools that we learn create expertise on the outside world also can be used back in our own internal world to begin to make ourselves better. In particular, though, when you have the mindset that this is a win-win situation, and I don't know if I'm emphasizing that enough, but the underlying assumption here is that nobody here is going to be blamed or called out as being bad. Instead, what we're trying to do is find a way for all of us to collaborate together so that we all get what we need in the end, including the consultant, the contractor, and ourselves. So what we've done is I don't know if many of you have seen the risk plans that are done on, or the risk tool that is used on the best value projects, but it looks very similar to this, and we've incorporated this same idea into across all projects. And so what this has begun is, for example, I've got a brand new project manager. He's young. He's great. He's got lots of energy. He's like 27 years old, out of architecture school, but he's really green. So if I sit down and I say to him, tell me, what do you think the risks are on this project? He's like, I don't know. I've never done a parking lot before. What is the problems? So I begin to sit down with him. I say, okay, let's think about this. What are you going to dig in the ground? What makes you find the ground? Oh, you might find contaminated stuff. Yes, you might find contaminated stuff. Let's put that down. Okay, what else might happen? Well, let's see. We have an issue in Nova Scotia where there's really only one contractor that rules the entire paving industry. So they're like, oh, we might get a bully for a contractor. He might push out all the other bids. How are we going to manage this? And we start to walk it through. And so not only then is the risk tool being used to manage the project, I'm using the risk tool to mentor a new project manager. And he actually, so we gave him a parking lot to do. It was $180,000 was the contract value, or it was less than $150,000. Project value was about $180,000. And he did really, really well. As a matter of fact, he actually delivered it under the original value of the PO. So there, it was negative change order. And he did that because in many ways he had a great contractor and a great crew with him that he was working with in terms of a consultant, but also because he used this tool on a regular basis to go back to people and say, look, I think there's a problem. How do we solve this together? And then the contractor would say, well, I don't know where to put that soil. We're going to have to bring in a unit to deal with it. And then the consultant would say, well, wait a minute, isn't there a site down in such and such a town where you can dump this and they've got a set up area already for this? And the contractor's like, oh, you're right. But it's only a certain type of load. And they're like, well, we should check and make sure, because maybe this will qualify. Sure enough, it did. So we had contaminated soils, but it ended up costing almost nothing to get rid of it because ironically, the consultant knew about a waste disposal area that the contractor didn't. Would we have had that conversation, maybe, without the tool? But definitely by having the tool, we ensured the conversation was going to happen, especially with a brand new project manager who was really very green on the wheels. So the great thing about this, though, too, is that once you've done that, if you have multiple projects, you can begin to roll them up. So let's say you have 20 projects, all with different risk schedules on them. You can begin to say, well, where are my most significant risks across a portfolio of projects? And that's what we're beginning to look at now, is saying, okay, we've got 20 or 30 projects on the go right now. Where are the risks that could actually really, really cause an impact to the university's core mission, let's say? Let's call those risks a 10. And every month, I produce a report for my boss, and I go up to him and I say, here's the things that could really cause you a problem. Here's the things you might get a phone call for. Because we know these are problems and they're coming. But also, here's how we're solving them. And there is a cost associated to them, yes, and there's a schedule impact, but I'm being very transparent with you. This is what could happen. Just having that communication in and of itself means that if one of those risks does actually begin to propagate and come to fruition, I've already got everyone prepped. And not only that, they know that we've got a plan to deal with it. Ironically, the surprise of coming up to someone that they didn't know there was a problem and then suddenly telling them there's a problem often produces a far worse reaction than the actual problem itself. So that's one of the ways we're also using it. And then to carry it even further, and honestly, by now, the project managers are starting to carry this on their own felt. So again, this young project manager said to me, you know, I learned a lot from that project. It was really great. I'm going to just go through all those risks, and I'm going to make a note to myself about how I manage them and what I would do next time to do it differently. And I was like, oh, that's great. So he added a column to it called Lessons Learned, and we've all done Lessons Learned exercises. And the idea, for those of you who have taken some of your project management courses, talk about organizational process assets, which is this idea that when you do something and you learn, you pass it down to the next person, and they are a little bit farther ahead. Well, in this case, then, we're actually saying, what were all the risks that happened on this job, and how did you manage them? What did you learn from them for next time? And as a result, for example, we just did a washroom where one project manager, she completed it, and another project manager said, oh, I've just got another job to do another set of washrooms, very similar, a bank of washrooms to the dormitory. Can you give me your risk register and all of your lessons learned? And sure enough, she just said, yeah, here they are. And he took that document to his consultant and put it down and said, look, guys, this is all the problems that we could see that could happen on this job. Let's plan for them now. Let's put it in the drawings. So that we don't repeat any of these mistakes that were on this or any of these risks that were on here. And so using the document then becomes for us, not just while we're doing the project, a useful tool, but also then a tool that we can pass it along to some other people down the line. And again, so for that new project manager, he's looking at it like, wow, this is great. I'm going to suddenly get all this knowledge out of these other project managers who are much senior than me. And he's seeing this, so that's one of the reasons I think why he's pushing it as hard as he is. He's very aggressive in that way, and I congratulate him on that. But it was actually the more seasoned project managers who are the ones who really have taken this on and pushed it on through the system so that we've been able to be successful at it. So again, risk-based approaches apply to non-value projects, best value projects. We're looking now at even expanding it so that maybe, and we have to get bigger buy-in to this, but using some of those same principles for strategic initiatives, which would be at the AVP or VP level of strategic initiatives for the university. What are your risks to those strategic initiatives? Why can't we use the same sets of tools? Why can't we report on it the same way? So we're looking at using that as well. And also, if you're interested, I can show you some later, the tool also provides you with metrics that become more and more useful the more and more you do it. For example, if you are tracking how many risks occur in a project, you have a metric. If you are tracking how long it takes for a risk from when it starts to when you complete it, you have a metric. If you are starting to track what the source of that risk is, you have a metric. And so all this information is beginning to accumulate and give us some interesting pictures, not only about ourselves, but also about how certain contractors perform and how certain consultants perform. Because all that information is now all tied together. So those are some ways, I guess, that it's expanded beyond just the simple, let's say, the procurement piece that you begin with. So there we go. So that's sort of a really fast overview of where we are at. And right now we're in our third year, and by no means are we perfect experts at all in the system. We've got a long way to go, but for us it's been very successful. And I'm just curious, does anyone have any questions, or is there any aspects of this you want me to expand on?
In this being a tool for collaboration, in the interview section of the process, do you limit that to the GCs type force, or do you bring the entire construction team in, significant players, and interview all of them?
Yes, the significant players. So that's more prevalent on the major capital, where you're going to have a number of them. But even on the smaller project, we'll ask for any significant subs to also be there. And again, the real key there is you don't want the boss. You want the project manager and you want the site super. And you interview them separately. And it blows their mind the first time. Matter of fact, one time we had it and the boss came and he said, "You're not kicking me out of this room because I'm not letting you beat them up." He thought we were going to bring them in and beat them up like a commercial owner would, to try to beat them down in price. I'm like, no, there's a script of questions. We're not going to beat anybody up. We're not even going to talk about money. You know, but yes, you bring in them all.
Well, how do you determine significance in that case?
You know, it's our best judgment, right? So you know, in particular, like if we were doing a HVAC upgrade in a building, and we're just talking if there was a mechanical component, we know that the controls are going to be really important. We bring in the control sub because we'd really want to talk into it, and it'd be the same sets of questions. You know, have you done a project like this before? Can you tell me what might go wrong and what you'll do to fix it? Those same types of questions, especially when you get down to, let's say, the site super level, you get some really interesting responses.
Dollar threshold, and where do you cut it off?
So the smallest one we've done was a demolition project that required abatement, and it was a good story though because we had two bids. We thought the job was about $110,000 or something $1,000. It turns out, I forget what the lowest bid was, but he was way low, like $50,000. And then the second bidder was close to our budget. And so we go through the process, and since there was only two bidders, which scared the bejeebas out of us, we brought them both in. We did the whole interview process with both of them, even though the one had terrible scores on their written evaluation. But we wanted to interview them anyway. And we said, okay, so you know, who are you going to bring in as your sub on the abatement? And he said, what abatement? And we were like, the abatement of the asbestos. And he goes, oh, I don't really handle that. I give that to my other guy. We're like, okay, who is that? And we named the subcontractor. And we realized this guy has no idea what he's doing. He hasn't even thought through this job. And the next person that came in, you know, they had a plan laid out. They knew how they were going to move materials. They knew where they were going to go and how the bags were going to be there. And the fact that yellow bags scare people, so they were going to move them out in off hours of the day and blah, 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 blah. And we're like, yep. And so it was not by any means given to the lowest bidder. So that's about the smallest one we've done.
Question here. Your change order rates that you showed, is that on the post-contract amount, or does that include your pre-award negotiations where the contractor may have identified some other risks or additional costs?
Right. So the what we've learned, so that evolved. At the beginning, when we were thinking kind of normal, we're like, okay, we're only going to do a contract for the base value, and then we're going to add any value adds in as a change order on top of that. But then we started getting smarter and started to talk to them. We were like, for example, we did a big stonework project where we had to do a bunch of sandstone, and you guys got done in the sandstone. And for us, we've left the sandstone so long that all the joints are just gone. And we have freeze thaw, so the edges are delaminating, you know. The contractor came in and said, guys, you severely underestimated how much sandstone repair you've got here. That was one of his risks that he came in. He said, I think it's really like this number, blah. It's not going to be blah. And we had just asked him to do a unit rate carried across an assumption of percentage. So what we did then was, instead of incorporating it as a change order, we used the planning document to bring it in as a value add, and then incorporate it in the base cost of the project. Because from our perspective then, it's not truly an unknown if, while we're still negotiating, they just come back to us and tell us, you've got extra costs here that you didn't perceive. you need to think about this before you sign the contract. So the 3% that you see there is now post value adds. That's an important question.
So there are two different denominators, though, then, really, in the 7.75 to start and the 3% post.
Yeah.
So in reality, or in some cases, your change order rate is in effect the sum of the two.
It could. Yeah. And certainly, in terms of meeting the original budget estimate, that value doesn't change. So our capacity to meet budget is often more, though, of a function of your ability to estimate. Because, as you all know, I'm sure very well, it's really easy to screw up your estimate and come up with a budget that's not that you can't reach. Or, conversely, to come up with a budget that's way too high. And then your client's still looking at you like, what are you doing? So actually, in another metric that I didn't show here, we also measure what we call return on encumbrance, which is a complicated way of saying how much money did you give back to the client at the end of the job. And that number also, we try to make it small. So we don't want to give much money back, and we don't want to have much in the way of change orders. That means that when we said to you it was 100K, we meant it was 100K. It wasn't too much higher, and it wasn't too much lower. And then we're not tying up clients' money on projects that we're not going to spend it. So we had a problem with that in particular where, you know, us being project managers trying to manage our risk, an easy way to manage risk was to throw a whole lot of contingency in. That was kind of a sloppy, lazy way to do it. And as a result, the university was like, yeah, that's not good. Stop it. You're tying up our money, and we want to spend that money on other things. Yes?
Yeah, just going back to the value adds for a moment. You have an opportunity during the clarification phase then to, I'll say, negotiate those value adds. It's not necessarily a price that was identified. It may be identified as part of the value add, but when it gets written into the contract, is it at change order rates with 10 and 5 overhead profit, or is the contractor negotiating in good faith and doing it as if it were part of his contract where he was determining his overhead profit based on competitive process?
Right. So we don't ever actually negotiate the price directly. And this is one of those key points where my colleague who runs Major Capital would disagree with me on this, because he comes from the commercial sector and he loves negotiating after, which he could do before he was under a procurement department, but now he can't. He's learning that. But so he has tried to negotiate after and had difficulty. But the way that we've run it on the few that we've had where we were putting in value adds is that we take the price that they give us and we don't negotiate. So for instance, they said it's a $70,000 change. We don't question it. We don't verify. We just either we take it or we leave it. Either we take what you're saying it is and it's good, or we're going to leave it off the table. The choice is ours, but the price is yours.
So they've identified a price as part of the value add, correct, which is part of their proposal.
Correct. Or a unit rate, and then all we're arguing over, or not arguing, all we're negotiating over is the quantity.
In a true CCDC2 scenario, I don't want to start talking a whole lot of legal here, though. You're getting into a situation where you are, in fact, receiving qualified bids.
Yeah.
I
don't want to get into the legal aspect of it in this audience, but the whole idea of a stipulated price contract is it's stipulated. If you provide any other information related to it, your bid is effectively qualified. And Paul and I can have that conversation. But I think there's an opportunity to again work amendments to our supplemental conditions. But I really think that it needs legal review to understand the construction contract that we would use.
So what
kind
of construction contract are you using?
We use a CCDC2 with supplemental conditions. And most of our modifications, I mean, we also use for the obviously construction management are different, but most of those have supplemental conditions that mainly modify the delay claims section. That's where we have the biggest chunk of new stuff.
Which is what we're doing here, too.
Yeah.
So, Glenn, I wonder if you can ask your question, and then Boris, could I ask you to ask the question you asked yesterday to John? You remember? Okay, so Glenn, you go ahead.
So just to follow up on, you said you don't negotiate. Obviously, you would vet that number, see if it's realistic and reasonable. But if it's a good idea, if the contractor has identified a real risk, I mean, there's got to be some, you're not going to just pay the moon, right?
Yep.
If you know it's worth $30,000, I mean, how do you manage that?
Well, that's interesting. So the theory is, and has worked so far, that what you're really attracting is people who are experts in what they do. And by vetting them through that process, they are the least likely to be the ones that are just trying to play a bait and switch or some other type of game with you, where they're going to like, ha ha ha, here's my $1 million change order that because you screwed up. Instead, that person is going to be the type who's going to be like, well, you did screw up, but here's a fair price, and I have some profit here because that's what I'm here for, but here's a fair price for what was missed, and you can take it or you can leave it. And at that point, if it's something really major, you can leave it in its entirety. But in our case, honestly, it hasn't been anything bigger than, let's say, $60,000 to $80,000. So in our world, at least, it hasn't been a deal breaker one way or the other.
And then, Boris?
Just a quick question. I'm not sure you actually touched on it, but the risk register that you put in place during the contract, is that something you guys do?
Definitely.
Concern we have here is that some contractors will flood you with all kinds of requests for information and all these type of things that they will put on the register as a potential a delay claim or all these type of things that could follow the lawsuit. What are your experiences with the contractors that you're working with, and how do you sign off on all the risks that they identify in the contract, which usually means it's somebody else's fault other than theirs?
Yeah.
It's either the consultant or the owner, or it could be a site condition, which is understandable.
Yeah. So there's always that fear that basically you use the risk tool as a means of just basically pointing fingers, and then that could lead to something horrible in the future. The setup of the entire arrangement is so that we are supposed to be trying to go into a collaborative relationship with the person that we're working with. It is, I suppose, theoretically possible that someone could be really sweet talking good and say all the right things and come in the door after the fact and then use the risk register as a way to stick it to you. But our experience has been the opposite, that the contractors who are actually really good, they love the risk register because they finally have a chance to be able to communicate and articulate the issues they're facing with you and find a way to deal with it in a way that isn't going to result in a massive blow-up, because they don't want that. They want to get to the next job and keep making money. What they would rather is that they had a process where they could just immediately communicate to you, we have a problem, let's say there's contaminated soils, we think it's this, we've got to sit down and talk about it, let's do that right away. And you're like, okay, let's take a look, we're going to look. And then later on you say, you know what, we've got a new risk. Our neighbors are starting to complain. They don't like seeing your equipment. They're starting to scream to our upper brass, we may be told to slow this project down. How can we avoid that risk? And you're starting to use it as a tool for dialogue, because that's the way it was set up to be used. In order though to get there, first of all, you gotta kind of get your own head in that space, that's the way you're gonna deal with the contractor. And then secondly, get the consultants and contractors also in that headspace. And it's a really steep slope at the beginning, because everyone at first just thinks, you've just found a new way to trick us. So we're going to figure it out, and then we're gonna trick you back, or something. Right.
So there's a risk there, though. They're documenting owners' changes and owners' delays at some point. And if the contractor decides to do the digits, he could use that, I guess, in the court if it goes that far.
Sure. So, in another way of looking at that, at least from the job is the job, the work is the work. There is a certain amount of risk involved in it. If you are replacing a steam line, which we just did, and you are digging through the ground in a city that's 230 years old, at least, you're going to hit something in the ground, and it's going to be something you don't know about. It's going to happen, but it's a risk, and it's going to be there. So knowing that, can we deal with that up front in a way that is going to be mutually beneficial? Now, if... I guess in a worst case scenario that might result in some sort of I guess, documentation, but I don't think having the fact that there was the risk that you were going to run into something in the ground and writing that down somehow makes that risk more of a risk than it always was to begin with. And if they do run into it and it does cause an enormous delay and you do end up in court, the fact that you just said it was a risk, you just said, well, it was a risk. But anyway, that's been our experience. Now, you know, the construction climate is different in every location and every little microclimate. In our case, at least, it's been the opposite. It's been used really as a tool of communicating with the contractors in a way that they were never used to communicating to us with before, particularly the site supers and the project manager. And they've really liked it.
The two-way list, is your project manager actually add to that list too, or is it generated
yes.
by the contractor?
No. So we usually make the contractor do the paperwork, although in some cases where we don't do best value, we do it. But it's that the consultant, the contractor, or the project manager, or we have the client also usually on those phone calls. So we usually do the risk reports as phone calls. They can, all of them can add to it.
Can I ask one
question?
Stupid.
Sure.
What sort of lead time again did you say this requires up front?
So we find that it adds about 2 weeks to the total procurement process. So whereas in our world, procurement process is about a 6 week process, this makes it about an 8 week process.
And on a major capital, have you done that, say on a $30 million building?
Again, it's really hard. It's much harder to evaluate that because if you go back and then you have to do a big post tender addendum and then things get messed up. You know, that can extend it longer than it seems. So, yes, it takes longer, but honestly, I don't really have a good grip on how much.
Now, on the one that we did, I would suggest we were a little bit longer than 2 weeks, but not by much. And it was
no,
because
I
it was the first one that we
was...
did. We extended the bid period a little bit so that
yeah.
we could educate contractors.
Thank you.
The
thanks,
clarification
guys.
Phase, I think, was in around that 2 week period.
Yes, it was, yes.
And Sahara, I know you've got to go on.
Have you tried the CCDC 11 and then going to CCDC 2 instead of going through BBBM? Did that work for you?
No. We didn't use the CCDC 11. And let me get it straight. So the 11
is the pre-qualification.
Right. And then 14 is...
So that way you weed out the bad ones and you only have people
right.
who you have... experience with, work with, call the references and done everything before you even let them bid.
So
don't try that?
No. So in our case, at least in my world, we haven't done any of the pre-qualification exercises. But if we were, I would highly recommend that we use best value to figure out which one of those people actually knows what they're doing and haven't just sent us their marketing gimmicks to make sure that we got the right
person. Yeah, no. I mean, going through full phone calls, calling the references, making sure, putting them for interview if you have to go through the financial records, all that stuff. So, okay.
Yeah.
Just wanted to check.
And Heather, you've been really patient. You had a question on so I know we had to get
no, thank you very much.
Great, again. Thank you.
So of the 18 projects that you've done, how are you picking which ones you're putting through the best value process? And then sort of long-term, what are your plans? Are you, like, eventually you want to put everything through best value, or how are you making selection?
That was similar, yes. So that cutoff question that I forget who he was, Paul Morris.
Morris
asked is similar. So at first, it was all about the project manager because I knew that in order to make this work, we had to get a project manager who was going to understand the concept, be already so well versed in whatever the project was that they could focus their energy on the best value component. So there was two project managers that I had that were very good and I knew who would be early adopters. So it wasn't so much about the projects as it was the managers, and we just simply took their next big jobs. And they were in the $1 million to $2 million range. Enough money on the table so that the contractors also will be interested, because the first time you do this with a contractor, you're asking them to do a lot of extra work they hadn't done before. So having done that, then we began to select projects based around high levels of risk, but those, and again, so we're starting to use the tool ourselves to figure out, okay, where are really our high-risk projects, why are they high-risk, and how would we address these with best value? So for example, the envelope one that I was explaining with the change order, we knew that building was leaking like a sieve, and we knew that there's going to be far more damage than what was just evident at the surface because of all the years leaking. So we're like, part of what we wanted to evaluate in the best value was bring somebody in who actually will understand the building and be able to tell us, yeah, I know that that's just like this, but I'll bet you the water's gotten behind, and when we do the backup wall, it's going to be all busted, and so, you know, we need to think about that, we need to think about this. And also, using best value for high-risk clients. So you probably have a client, right? And one who's very, you know, keen on keeping the budget down, but also steps in and suddenly takes over when they shouldn't, and then walks away and asks you to clean up the mess, but then, you know, on and on and on. And meanwhile, your contractor's getting red in the face and saying, I'm never working for you again, this is BS. When you get that, it's like, what we want to do there then is actually, we're doing the best value process, and we pull that client into the process, and we say, why don't you help us evaluate? And what that does is it gets them starting to become involved and thinking about, if I tell them to do this, there's going to be a risk. If there's going to be a risk, there might be change. The change could cost me money. And it begins to start to involve them so that they are also educated as to what's going on, but in a way that kind of makes them still feel like they're in control because you're evaluating someone. You understand what I'm saying? So you kind of can spin it a number of different ways and how you're, you know, who it is you're aiming the risk at that you're trying to solve with the best value process.
Thanks. So, but what about Heather's question about will you do more best value? So recognizing will you look, I mean, I don't think it fits for everything,
no.
Right? I just don't think it's a one size fits all.
No.
But at the same time, where you can, will you use it or?
Yes. So the real issue will be at a certain point, the administrative overhead won't be worth the value of the actual work itself. And so what I mean by that is that by, let's say, a $500 item.
Oh, yeah, small projects.
Yeah, that's not going to make
sense.
Well,
we talked last night about like 50,000 and under, you don't look at it.
Probably not.
Right.
Again, unless there was some really, really good reason there was high risk there. But we are using the ideas all the way down. So for instance, that young project manager I was telling you, his normal job is to manage all the small stuff. Replace a door, I need these windows all need to be swapped out. He'll do small stuff like that. But now he's starting to use those tools in his normal day-to-day work, which is making him a better project manager. It also helped me, and for those of you who do it, it helped me in hiring people. Because, as you know, some people are really good talkers, but there's almost nobody yet who I've met who could talk their way out of that question, you know, walk me through the steps, tell me what could go wrong, and how will you fix it? It's an almost impossible question to fake. So bringing in one of the best project managers I've hired since, I asked her that question, and she answered it like an ace. Even the person who was interviewing with me from HR, who knows nothing about projects, really was like, wow, is that amazing or what? And I was like, yes, I definitely want to hire her. And she's turned out to be excellent. So you see those tools that you sort of learn and how to evaluate then also can be turned internally and help ourselves kind of grow and become better at what we do as well. Sir?
Yes. You mentioned to make your contracts mutually beneficial and not scare away the good contractors. Does that mean you negotiate your contracts or you just sanded them down to remove the rough parts for the contract?
You know, it's funny. I don't know what your situation is like here, but Nova Scotia is not a wealthy province. So we have far easier time telling people no on the contractual level because they just need the work. I've had guys come in and their hands are shaking as they're signing a contract because they've never signed a contract in their life. No, we actually have our full force supplemental conditions in place, and we've been so strict about it that nobody dares come against us. But when we add in the planning portion, so I don't know if all of you know this, but after you negotiate the planning portion of it, you actually insert a document on the back of the contract that includes some additional terms of which they have some control over. Not necessarily not general conditions, but they're terms of the work. And that allows them an opportunity to express some of the issues that they may have. Of course, we don't let them touch indemnity or anything like that. But, yeah.
Okay.
I don't know what your situation is, honestly. What's your...
I haven't been involved in any of that.
Yeah, in that case, we took our standard front end, which is our supplemental conditions,
yep.
And I think morphed them together. And I think we were in the same situation with our first project is that we want to definitely learn from it. And actually, so did the contractors. You went through the debriefs yesterday, and I think you shared with me last night that, you know, the vast majority of the contractors that you debriefed took it as a positive and a learning opportunity. So I don't think they were going to push the bounds of any contractual obligations in order to experience
it. I don't think so. And the fact that we released that with the RFP, with the supplementary conditions, they've had a chance to vet that. And one of the things I said to SEM when we were in the clarification, now look at the contract and see what terms are not acceptable. She came back, she said, we looked at it, it was fine. And it was done.
And we had the broad spectrum of general contractors on this, from some of the largest in the country to ones that have just established themselves in the last couple of years and have done a couple of small projects for us. So it was really interesting to have that cross-section. I wanted to come back just to the risk reporting tool, because that's one aspect of BVBM on the PM side that we're really interested in and want to implement across the board. And what I'm curious about is the rhythm of weekly reports. Contractors generating those weekly, you answer part of my question is that you deal with these by way of phone calls. How often do those phone calls happen then?
Yes, so we do a weekly. We do insist on the weekly. Mm-hmm. I mean, usually, again, there is some variance in terms of the size of the project and what is exactly going on. So some projects go foul for a couple months while you're waiting for a piece of equipment to arrive. That isn't the time. You're not going to talk every week on that. But in general, when you're in full construction, it's once a week. And at first, I'd say the first meeting might take, I don't know, half an hour, 45 minutes, maybe even longer, depending on, you know, everyone kind of getting used to what it is you're doing. And then they usually get down to like 5-10 minutes, even less, because it usually becomes rote. And everyone gets it that, like, the point of the conversation is to find out if there's anything that we need anyone else to be doing. You could almost call it just, you know, a mutual discussion. We were talking about another way to name it. A discussion time for what might go wrong on the project and what we're doing about it, which would be something that, I mean, most of the principles and the best value stuff, like, this is just common sense that if probably we weren't in an institutional environment and we were really good at what we were doing, we would just be doing this anyway, right? If you were, let's say, you were a developer and you're building buildings, you'd be like, okay, I want to have good people building my buildings. I want to do it cost effectively. I want to make sure that I, you know, meet my market's needs, but don't waste too much money doing it. You start to think these things through, and if you were good and honest and integral about what you were doing, you would try to find good workers who were, you know, took pride in their work, who were experts. You'd pay them well enough, but not too well, but not too badly, making sure they didn't die. And then also you make sure that you yourself got enough of, you know, response in terms of low change order rates. You don't want to have things slip over schedule. I mean, that's just common sense. All this is doing is taking that and applying it back into an institutional environment in such a way that some of the ways in which we previously made our assumptions about how we need to manage vendors, how we need to control them, how we need to make sure that we're always on top of the contractual terms, but also micromanaging, starting to remove some of those myths, partly because they were created by ourselves and the way we've been engaging the construction community all of us across Canada, the United States, have been engaging the construction community for decades and decades and decades. And we can't go in and change them, but we can change us.
Do you do your site meetings bi-weekly? It's typically what we do. Depending
on the project.
Depending on the project. Frankly,
the site meeting piece becomes almost wrapped into the risk, because if there's something really bad going on and you're like, oh, okay, I'm going to come down, right? Because you're going to find out about it at that risk. Oftentimes, they'll do the other way that they've done it on projects is have the risk meeting with the site meeting.
That's what I wanted.
At the same time, and it just becomes like the second item on the agenda after safety. Right? Safety, risk. Which really, safety is almost its own risk, right? And so far, at first, it sounds onerous, but it really isn't. It really isn't once you get into it. Because the lines of communication are so much more clear when you're talking in those terms.
So, do you do open public tenders, or do you do RFPs?
Well, both. But in my world, with the smaller projects, under $5 million, it's almost all public. The only But even our RFPs, if the value is, we have an internal rule that if the value is over 25K for an RFP or over 100K for construction, it has to be funded. I don't know what your rules are.
Does that mean you open them publicly or you just post them?
We post them publicly.
Yeah, but do you open anything publicly?
No. They're all done through procurement. Do you guys do public openings? You do one envelope or two?
A mix. Occasionally two, depending on the complexity.
So one of the things that, and I don't know, kind of a comment and a question, but one of the things that I hadn't actually thought about in terms of the weekly risk report was a few slides ago where you talked about taking that and actually creating a body of knowledge that then you pre-populate projects, right, that have similar risk profiles.
Right.
I find that to be a really interesting concept because while that knowledge might reside, for example, in a PM, and let's say Mike and Sahar, another PM might not have it. And so actually pre-populating projects actually allows for that basis, like to kind of share the knowledge in a way where we're so quick, fast-paced, that sometimes I think it's really hard to do that. I find that to be a pretty interesting concept. So how onerous is that to compile, shall we say, all that risk data to actually create profiles of projects?
So we're not, I mean, we've only got 18, so we're not.
Yeah, you're still starting.
We're still starting. One of the issues is going to be how to compile that in a way that, let's say, we all got run over by a bus, but then all these brand new people could all of a sudden find it. And we're not quite there yet. But right now the way it's working is that, so there's 11 project managers, and in our group we all work in generally the same area. Everyone generally sees and hears everybody. Now project managers are kind of a lone wolf type breed. Every one of them has their own little world and has their own way of doing things.
Is that true?
Well, we're all unique just like everybody else.
Exactly. There you go. That's it, exactly. Yes. So therefore, they tend to, want to be able to do their project their way. And, don't mess with that. And so you got to be able to have some leeway for that to allow each one to have a different mechanism, but at the same time try and standardize at least the way that we're communicating so that if someone new does come in, they can actually understand what's going on. And so right now, again, the easiest, the ones who've adopted the quickest are those actually on the lowest end of the totem pole in terms of experience. Because they're the ones, in terms of the OPA, Operational Process Assets, or Organizational Process Assets, and the lessons learned, because they're the ones who want more than anything else to get that knowledge out of the more experienced ones. The more experienced ones are less apt because they don't need the tool as much. They have a better idea of what they're doing. We'll see how that goes over time.
So one of the things I did note too is, and I know, so Dalhousie is part of the U15 group of research intensive universities, okay, so although smaller than Western, is still one of the research intensive 15 in Canada. I didn't notice a lot of research projects on there, so is that because you felt that to be higher risk at the beginning to do this, and do you plan actually on incorporating research projects?
So for us, research projects, in particular research renovation, which would be most of the CFIs, which I'm sure you folks do. We have a bit of a unique way of implementing those. We have gotten really, really good with our internal trades force in executing those projects under market value. So we, at this point, unless we had a really big research, so for example, we've got one building, we've got two levels of shell space, and it all needs to be upgraded eventually to become that we may consider, but the majority of our research projects are actually done in-house by our own internal trades. And I know we're quite unique in that. Most universities don't necessarily have that kind of a trades force. So we right now, for example, we're doing a $1.5 million psychology lab renovation, all with in-house trades. That's why you wouldn't see one caught there. But if that wasn't the case, and honestly, that managing risk that way has been really, had a really good track record of it. But if we didn't have that trades force, if somebody that disappeared, then I'd definitely be putting those projects out to best value for a lot of good reasons if working in the mechanical electrical systems and labs.
So how are you evaluating your internal people are cheaper than market value?
The cost per square foot.
Okay.
So a couple times we have put it out because we haven't been able to, and time after time after time, it's far more expensive. And that's because the contract, the real reason, again, is all back to risk. So our internal trades, when they walk into a building, one of our buildings, Tupper Medical Building, they know what they're getting into. They know this floor has glass pipes, that floor has blue Orion. We know that all of the propane is run under the floor and you have to poke up, which means that you're going to be disrupting the floor below the renovation actually more than you are the floor itself. All that is already in their heads. When a contractor comes in and looks at it, they are like, oh, geez, I've never done anything like this before, right? And they start to put in the, this is, you know, what we find, right? They got to put in the risk because they've never done it. But we've done it so many times, we've got the risk pretty well handled. But that's a unique situation, I think that's common.
It'd be interesting to make the comparison with your campus at Dow campuses, I guess, right? At Dow to Western. So you're sharing a little bit with us last night. How many campuses do you have?
So we have four, technically. So we...
Go ahead.
Yeah. So the, you know, with a variety of buildings, of which we have everything from, you know, what we call ironstone, which would be similar to your sandstone buildings, all the way on up to little, a whole bunch of little houses all over the place that we have to maintain, which are a real pain and very ineffective. And also we have an agricultural campus, which is about 60 miles away, that is everything that you think an agricultural campus would be that we just amalgamated with. So we do everything from chicken coops to zebra fish.
we're trying to find out if we have a chicken coop on campus. Mike thinks there might be one to grow all the way south.
Is that the question you're asking?
And how many buildings in total?
So it's 165-ish, or 63.
But a lot smaller.
Yeah. Yeah. Oldest building that you have to deal with?
Oh, the oldest building I have to deal with is the Forest Building. It was built late 1800s. So, you know, that would be 140, 150 years old. Has a solid granite foundation, cut stone, which is, you know, phenomenal when you look at it, like, wow, that's not going anywhere. What is the oldest building here?
1922. So just coming up to 100.
Okay. And was it one of the sandstone neo-Gothic beginnings? I was amazed walking around the campus, seeing all the sandstone. I love it architecturally, but as a facilities manager, just scared the bejeebus out of me. But Mike was telling me that it's not that big a deal.
Well, Craig Fellner's not here. He has to deal with all of the building envelope issues. And I mean, it's a big part of our deferred maintenance. But as I was saying, the solid stone exterior walls give us, in some ways, less grief than cavity wall construction, to tell you the truth.
That's a piece of reaction.
Other questions for you? That's your opportunity. Someone who's done more than we have, certainly on the construction side. We've done a lot in services, but not so much. I mean, we're inching our way through.
Has anyone, who here has actually done ones? Has anyone here done?
Yes,
yeah, so Mary has. So Mary and Mike and a number of, and Carmen, were on the utility and infrastructure study.
Melinda's done
elevators.
Elevators. Carmen did elevators. Melinda's done furniture. Paul's done waste management. What else have we done?
Moving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So those folks who have done that, just for my sake, what did you think about it? Was there anything in particular that was a problem, or that was difficult, or that went really well?
My project is still underway. At first, it was a little struggle for everyone in the evaluation committee because we wanted to see more about the project plan, and we didn't think of that. So until later, we thought, yeah, maybe we should have incorporated this as part of the submission. But otherwise, we were able to save $500,000 compared to other bids just by going through the best value process. So it was.
And taking a leap of faith, eh, Mary?
Yes.
It really was a leap of faith in the end after quite a bit of vetting. We put that contractor through, I don't know, a few rounds of
free clarification.
Thank you. Free clarification. Yes, we added a new phase for that project because we really just didn't believe what we were seeing. Right? $500,000 disparity in terms of what they said they could do. There was, I think there was just some disbelief, and we needed to get ourselves comfortable and, you know, supported by John saying, well, no, you really can't. Shouldn't do that, but okay, we can stretch it to do this, and then we did stretch it to do like a pre-clarification phase. So before we wasted too many people's time. But I mean, I would say from how they hit the ground running, they had done their homework, and so far so good. We don't have an outcome yet, but I think it'll be a success. One that, and I did share this yesterday in the architects meeting, I didn't name names, I can within this group, but it was interesting. So many of you know that we did best value for transferring the RIF, right? So our registered income fund outside, which has been managed with the pension team and by with pension investments at Western. And that process started about 18 months ago, and we actually selected Sun Life through the best value process. And I had the opportunity to be in another presentation with them last week, and I sat next to their business development person. And she said to me that it's probably the best procurement process she's seen in some time. And it actually, not only for them, like they actually took a lot of the learnings back and have internalized those learnings into their own processes. Because they actually said, now we know exactly what experts we want to put in front of clients. We know exactly who we should and who we shouldn't be. And I mean, they did another presentation to the Joint Pension Board last week, and they were outstanding. Every single person was bang on in their own respective area of expertise. And but it was interesting that she said she found that to be such a great process, because it had them really self-reflecting as well. And they've now taken a lot of those learnings and put them in their own process. So, you know, when it becomes mutually beneficial like that, I think that's a great outcome.
Yeah. And reaching down in to realizing that, you know what, when you start evaluating other people this way and actually bringing it back to yourself and how you're doing your work, it begins to create this generative process where we're starting to actually be able to reflect on ourselves in a way where it's not about criticism, but it is about trying to find a win-win scenario. And can we do that? Can we make ourselves better? Why don't we use the same tools that we're trying to make the contractors and the consultants work better for us? It sort of makes sense, but it's a little bit difficult to apply at first. However, it's so far worked really well. I mean, again, we're in the third year, I don't think there's any, the only negative components that I've ever heard, I guess, come back have been around that original time that it takes to put the planning in place. And sometimes that can be problematic. But most of the time, once you get through that and you're actually into the project itself, people are like, oh, this is great that we did that. I don't know, for you, was the pre-planning or clarification? It sounds like it was pretty
It was very, but I think it's reflective of who they put on the project. If it's a good project manager, that should always be done ahead of time anyways. But how do you develop the cost model to put in the bid if you don't pre-plan and look at all the drawings? We had a really good project manager. In other instances, it was very painful. It was a long period because it was such a new concept for the vendor that it was a struggle.
Sure.
But we made it through, and the end result was very positive, and it saves us a lot of time in day-to-day management of that vendor. So yeah.
You just raised a good point, though, that we haven't talked about, which is education of your vendor community and our consultant contractor community. And so certainly we did, I think, a good job on the Windermere in educating the contractors. You've done a good job on the vendor service side. But you know what? We kind of missed the consultants. And so we started, Mike, yesterday, and bringing the consultants on board, because they're a party to us, or with us, to these contracts. And certainly, you know, they don't have a contract with the contractor, but nonetheless, you know, they're part of that collaborative team that needs to get this happening. And so,
to speak to that, I did bring Mick and Dave Baker in prior to going out to Windermere Manor and educate them on the best value process. And I've included them in everything. I've asked for their input into the evaluation. I didn't put two of them. I said, you combine your scores, just because it can go either way. You know, they can be insulted by what somebody says, or they can be very supportive. So we got them, and they're part of the list. So it I think it's working well.
I don't know if you mentioned it when I was out, but have you talked about how the designer that a consulting community has taken on here? Because that's been a concern recently with construction, that the designers are going to be resistant to the to the reporting.
Well, you're actually doing best value on the consulting side now.
We did our first one, yes, on a major capital project, and it was resistant. So the best values definitely gets the heaviest amount of resistance by the consultants, and it's because the contract, at least in my opinion, is because the contractors see this as an opportunity for, look, if I really know what I'm doing, I can actually make a go at this job and I can make this work. I can make money, right? Because I can finally get down on the table and everything, breathe a sigh of relief and see if you take it. If you don't take it, fine. But if you do take it, I know it's a good job, I'm gonna make money. It doesn't have to be a killing, but it's gonna be something for them. The consultants, on the other hand, their business model is different. They're not running margins, right? It's all about who are you? What's your name? Did you hire a blah, blah, blah architect or a blah, blah, blah architect? And if suddenly you enter into an evaluation process where their names are removed and you don't know whether or not this is star architect versus not star architect, all you're looking at is does this one sound like they can actually manage, you know, the risks, and this one maybe not? Then you've really taken a big portion of their, it's called business model, away from them. So at first, all the consultants are like, no, this is a bad idea. And the way we first got them involved in it, that produced some positive results, was bringing them into the pre-planning or the clarification phase as consultants to listen to what the contractor was saying and provide us feedback on their opinion as to the viability of, let's say, a value add. And that was using them in their purpose, which is to consult with. Saying, look, this guy's saying this. What do you think, consultant? Does that sound reasonable? Does that sound right? We had one, for example, guy came in and said, you know what, I can save you $60,000 in this job because the scaffolding that the architect spec is overdone. I've got a cheaper scaffolding because I own it. I don't have to rent the other. I can put this up. Fine, we brought him in. We started talking about this. Architect pipes up. He says, well, okay, that's great. He says, but look, you're going to need to hold these lifts of brick up in the air. Are you sure it will actually hold them? Because, you know, you got to suspend the brick up there so they can work on it. That's why I spec the heavier system. And he's like, yeah, as a matter of fact, I have an engineer stamp that says it will. And so we were like, okay, is that good enough? And the architect says, yeah, if he's got an engineer stamp, that's good enough. So we took the value add. And by doing so, we also made the architect feel like he was valued, which is key, because remember, consultants, especially architects, go into the business because they want to build great things, because they want to become an architect of some notoriety. And if you take that
you
away
can
from...
You say that because you are one, right?
Exactly.
So you gotta tell
yes, I'm not a registered architect, but I was trained as an architect. And so that allows them to still be what they are and be good at what they are. And then they begin to see, okay, well, it kind of does make sense to talk to the contractor before we sign up. Maybe this isn't such a bad idea, but don't do it to me. And so we did do it to them now once. And the best architect in the city, who, in my opinion, is a very integral man, who's also done a lot of great projects, but he's very honest, he's my litmus test. When he turns, then I'll know we've done it right. And he hasn't quite turned yet. He's like, well, he didn't win, by the way, so that was kind of sour. But he's like, you know, I'm not quite sure. And I was like, well, let's talk it through. But he was getting to the point where he's like, I can kind of see how this will work. But still, they're resistant. And I think that's status quo from what I hear.
You need the services. There was one that we did before that held it, the one for environmental consultant, but it was a hybrid. So it was all the forms, the whole process, but we could see the names of the consultants. And most people, and there are many firms, even the bigger ones, they didn't submit a proposal for that project because they were shying away from the different business model. And in the end, we end up with a great consultant, very reasonable rates, everything. But I was surprised to see the big players in submit a proposal. And I was thinking maybe it's because they really shied away from best value.
We did all the concepts.
Mm-hmm.
Except the only thing that wasn't blind.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Other than that, it was.
Yeah.
And the big ones shied away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What about the consultants that you've retained through traditional methods that are working on best value construction projects?
Yes.
How they?
So the first thing they say is, "That's an extra." Like, okay, you know, you got us right, because it's a little more work to have them come in and do some of this. We also expect them to be part of the risk. Which we then say, no, that's just part of your regular site contract admin. And after a while, at first, they're like, wow, this is so much. But over time, we've then gotten it into our scope of services, that doing the best value will be part of your scope of services. And frankly, after a while, we've had one architect in particular who's gone through it a couple times now, and he's just gotten used to it. Time will tell, I guess, how that works out. I think it'd be really good. One of the metrics we've gathered, of course, when we gathered all the metrics, so I was saying how what you could do is by doing a number of these projects, you begin to start to see trends. One of the trends we saw was that our source of risk was significant from the consultants. So it begins to give us an opportunity to go back to the community and say, okay, here's the thing, is we've actually started to crunch the numbers now, and we've noticed a trend. How can we work with you, not blaming you, how can we work with you so that we can solve this problem? Because you don't want to have errors and omissions in your documents. You sure as heck don't want them because you know we'll pay for them. And then later on, when things take twice as long, you'll come asking us for more fees because the project's longer because your drawing's bad, right? We want to get out of that cycle. How do we do that? But without actually having data in your hand where you can say, here it is, like this is why, it becomes anecdotal. And people, have all their excuses why it isn't that way or another way. And in particular, we find that, again, I'll pick on poor architects, but it's been the architects who are most resistant to it. And I don't know what the association's like here, but in Nova Scotia, the association has been fairly arm's length about it. They haven't been against it, but they certainly aren't embracing it. So I'm sure that's going to be a challenge.
Have you ever had the architects actually participate in the risk assessment during the evaluation part?
Yeah, so we allowed that a couple times. It became clear to us that that might not be a great idea because they have more of a conflict of interest than it may be first apparent, particularly in our case where in some cases the contractor pool is small. So they may be working with those contractors on another job right now that we don't even know about. And that puts them in a little bit of a risky spot when they're evaluating them, that same contractor for the next. As you all know, sometimes contractors and consultants hide each other's errors, but you end up paying anyway. Right? So then, if that situation's happening, and then that contractor comes in front of them, and they've got to evaluate them, you see the kind of... So instead, we've limited that and more included them in the consulting role. But we allow them, for example, if we see a value add or a risk, mm-hmm. and we want an opinion, we'll ask.
Doug, you're shaking your head. That's true?
Yeah, I would say so. Maybe with the relationship between contractors and consultants, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. It can be scary, especially roofing. Tories. Yeah, we always got into the habit of hiring a third party just to verify the roofing. Because it's like, wait a minute, we have a bad roof, but both you said it was good. How did that happen? Why is there water in there?
Comments? I mean, Melinda, I wonder if you want to reflect on your best value projects that you've done too, right?
We did the movers. It's hard for my project because I don't have a lot of metrics on other projects to compare. We did one project that was a furniture portion of a project. I would say it went well. I would say the upfront part did take a lot longer. And I definitely saw some added values, and that was really in the reporting. So to make sure that there were no surprises, I think it can be. It's difficult. I didn't have metrics to compare. And then the collaboration project we did for the Mustang Market, well, we've never done that before, so we have nothing to compare it to.
And that was difficult because we were working with Laurier, and it
right.
was very different expectations and,
yes.
and plans on how we would use the outcome of
yeah.
the of the RFP,
mm-hmm.
so.
And then the movers, I wasn't involved in the last minute project, so I can't compare how that process went, so it's time.
Yeah, I know on furniture, I think you would, I don't want to be the most, but the time may not have added value in the process, so we'll have to look at that, right? And
yeah,
that may be a dollar value.
It's maybe tougher, I don't know.
Yeah, that one took a long time. We ended up with 6 or 7 different contracts that we had to finalize, and there was some tips and tricks that we were told to mm-hmm. avoid or watch out for, and we didn't necessarily do that.
Right.
Laurier led the RFP versus
oh.
Western, and so there was some recommendations that I don't think we listened to as effectively as we should have. I'll say.
It's true. I mean, these two guys actually really kind of do say most everything they say kind of does work out the way they said it would. So we've tried to use it in our own little ways. We've tried to bastardize it in a couple different ways. Usually when they say that's a bad idea, it has been a bad idea. So, you know, you really do need a little bit of guidance with this. It sounds easy in some ways, but it really isn't. And there's a lot of details in the way that you implement it that are really, really important because we're in an institutional environment and there's some reasons for why certain things are the way they are. They become more apparent once you've done it a couple times. Kind of the most dangerous thing is like the sophomore who's done it once. And, you know. So we've been there too. And I think even the way we are using best value now to work on some of our non-best value procured projects may, I'm sure we're going to find all of our problems. I'm sure we're screwing something up. That's okay. Because what we learned is that we're part of the problem, which means that we're also part of the solution. We can change ourselves. So, you know, I think that's really the big takeaway for us as an organization is that big piece of learning. And Legal's just left. But when you learn that as a group, and then you all look at each other as, I guess, you know, comrades on that road to getting better, it begins the seeds to then even finding contract. You attract that same energy back to yourself. And the contractors you begin to hire also begin to pay that respect back to you. And hopefully, maybe the consultants will eventually as well. That's why I started with that first slide that said, you know, what was the problem? What did we learn?
And that, to me, was evident in the debriefing. The one vendor that I was most concerned about was the most supportive. They liked the process. They knew they weren't going to win, but they wanted to work through that process.
For the next time.
And they wanted to see, are we going to do this again with larger size projects? All of the vendors in the debriefing said that.
Yeah,
I said what?
So.
Say again?
All of the vendors in the debriefing yesterday want to know if we're going to move forward with this.
With a larger scale project.
Yes.
Yeah, the majority said they only came into the debriefing to actually see if you were going to do everything we said we were going to do. And at least five of them said, mm-hmm. We didn't believe you weren't going to go a little bit here.
Yeah.
So that's the only reason they walked into that debriefing.
Interesting.
I do have a question. Looking back 3 years, is there anything you would have done differently if you could redo it again? Was there any major lessons learned? I mean,
the problems, the greatest problems were always internal. So when there was an issue internally, someone didn't agree with the way things were going to happen, it was usually because we didn't bring that person on board as part of what it was that we were trying to do in a way that met their particular needs. So, for example, my basically opposite on major capital, he had some real concerns about it coming off from the beginning. Until he had some experience procuring things in an institutional environment. If I were to do that over again, instead of popping it on, I would have said, why don't you have a go doing one of these projects the normal way using our system. I would have let them go through that and then afterwards had said, now we have another way of doing it. Would you consider thinking about doing it? Because then at least, now he has since turned mostly around about it, but not entirely. Still, he has some reservations because really the best value system kind of incorporates some ideas of collaboration that he just doesn't believe are possible. But bringing him on board in a more, I guess, softer way would have been something I would have changed. And I think also internally with the way that we did our projects, we had good buy-in from all the different players, but maybe we thought it was going to be easier than it was at first, because it really does sound easy. And everyone at least had the idea once that, oh, we don't even need to really get in training, we'll just go start doing risk tools, and that shouldn't make any good. And I know you guys heard that a lot, but it is true. And so probably if I was giving advice to someone new, I'd say, do you know what, just get that idea out of your head, take the training, it's more complicated than things, then you think, do it a couple times, then start to maybe play with it a little or think about how you might change it or jiggle it a little bit.
I wonder if I could put a question to John or Jeff to say, so you've done this across really North America, for the most part, right? So what is the largest construction contract that
that you've done at any client, so that, because I know you work for private companies as well as universities, by best value. What's the largest dollar value?
It's somewhat classified, but...
Well, you don't have to tell who.
Well, even the number, they don't want anyone to know, but it's...
greater than...
It's pushing $1 billion.
$1 billion.
Okay. I was expecting a much lower number.
Yeah.
$1 billion construction.
Yes.
Wow. Okay. I didn't think about that, but... Who wants to run that project?
I mean, before, you know, this one, I would say the largest was around $200 million. We've done some wastewater treatment plants, but the average out of the 1,000 construction projects is probably within $100,000 to $300,000.
The average.
And most of the construction projects have been for universities. You know, University of Minnesota, we ran about 300 projects there, so. They were all similar, you know, renovation, mechanical, electrical.
Not new buildings?
A few new buildings, but most of it was renovation, but that all fell still under capital, the capital planning group. Their FM only did projects under $10,000. But yeah, close to $1 billion is the biggest construction.
Yeah, and that's new. John's working on one now that's a renovation. Historic renovation in a big city, lots of issues. That's going to run 100 to 150 million.
To extend that question, although you didn't quite ask it, if I were to give any advice to anyone new, it would be pick one or two people in your organization who are capable, willing, and interested in trying this out, and let them give them the power to run it. And then that will improve your chance of success greatly, because you'll be letting them be who they are, but letting them do it within the confines of this new process. And then let them come back and tell you how it worked. Because you hear me say it, or you hear folks from ASU say it, those are, you know, we're strangers. But when someone hears their own, you know, the person who sits next to them going on and on about it, it has that much more weight. And then it begins to generate the conversations that need to begin to change people's attitudes towards how you approach contractors, how you approach consultants. And then after a while, it seems sort of obvious that, well, didn't we always just like call them in and talk to them about the job before we hired them? Didn't we do that? What, you didn't do that? And it becomes like that. But in order to get from A to B, and A is, you know, the contractor's out to get you, we have to play the game, it's, you know, game of chicken, and then to somehow transfer that mindset to know we're actually moving together in the same way, and it's got to be mutually beneficial for this to actually work. It's a whole lot of, like, you know, water cooler conversations. It's a whole lot of meetings like this, but then smaller, you know, and it's some successes and some failures. It's all that that really produces the change in the long run. So if there are some interested folks, you know, who kind of champion it at first, that would be my advice for how to get it going. It's the spark that fits the fire. So that's what worked for us in particular.
Any more questions? So let me just thank you very much for being with us today. Really appreciate the ability to talk to you last night as well. And I know, and thank you, Doug, for taking Ian on a tour this morning. I think you guys could have been gone for a while longer.
Yeah.
You were having too much fun.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that one good thing that I heard is that Ian learned some things from us as well in terms of our controls and our West Controls group, because Doug was his guy. So, of course, I think that became a nice way for us to add value, hopefully, to Ian's trip. So thank you so much for being with us, and thank you to Jeff and John as well.
Thank you.